Can you know, as an entrepreneur sharing his own real world perspective of raising money? What did you feel about any new things?
Some good points here, like understanding and investment, and the energy in the future. Because it's a long story, but it's so that's how
So how many of you have actually gone into the market to approach investors or are thinking of approaching investors?
Thinking is
not that thing.
All of us are thinking of what?
Not right. Investor is bank or
equity investor. So, I'll just start with the one slide when I just, I'm not sure if this is the right time to be doing a lengthy PowerPoint presentation at 5 o'clock in the evening. And how many of you are familiar with the process of capitalism? Have any of you through second-hand knowledge or from your friends, etc., have sort of understood the process? You have. What about the rest of you?
Whatever you read in, you know.
So what have you read about capitalism?
Whatever this you keep reading about, you know, pros and cons and, you know, different kind of funds and which fund invest where, and you know, often you would have list of people who are investing in this kind of, you know, sector and stuff like that.
So what are the questions that you want me to sort of answer? I mean, I can go on and on about, because this is like you said, this is a 6-month process, it could turn out to be a 1-year process. There are so many things that we can discuss. But from your point of view, what are the things that you think that I should do?
As a for-profit enterprise, we're always in doubt to who to invest, who to go to. There are two kinds of investor. One is an impact investor. One is Sequoia right now. They end up being investor and invest in this many companies. They might be interested in our traditional distribution model. So who to go to? What are the flip sides of an impact investor? What is the flip side of regular investor? So impact investor always looks at social impact. However, a regular investor just, you know, is concerned more about. So, as a for-profit enterprise,
one thing you want answered is what kind of investors you want.
So, there, I can just segregate them in two types. Something like an Acumen fund versus a Sequoia, I suppose. For a for-profit enterprise that is setting up a distribution network, for any one of us.
Anything else?
Say, you know, an impact investor, what kind of returns are they looking at? So, you know, your mainstream investor, venture capital, would probably look at whatever max that you can get out of it.
Okay. Yes, sir.
Agriculture cannot be multiplied very fast. And if that is done,
enterprise in both
bounds. So you are asking whether just specifically about social impact investors or generally how will investors
or social impact? How do you execute?
Anybody else? Any other things that you want to answer?
What is the right time to approach an investor? It's a good question.
What is the right time to,
you know, when you need the money or when you don't need the money?
So, I'll just start with a brief explanation of the process. How does the, he was talking about the 6-month process, the capital raising process. So, when you start out on a capital raising process, the first thing that happens is, like you said, you have to select investors, right? You have to prepare the business plan, etc. That was explained in the morning. The second thing is you have to start approaching the right kind of investors. You have to select the right kind of investors. That's what he was talking about. Once you do that, then there is a initial discussions happen in terms of they come, look at, do a field trip, look at your operations, try to understand your operations in more detail. All that stuff happens, and at the same point in time when they're doing that, they also try to evaluate you as a promoter, and also sort of initial discussions happen on the terms, right? If they're very convinced about the investment, they must start discussing the terms at a particular point in time. Terms, and by terms I mean the terms of their investment. Could be like they send you feelers about what kind of valuation number you're looking at, right? So those are things that happen at that stage. And once this process, typically this process would take about, it depends again, but about 2 to 3 months, this whole process. And when Anil was talking about why you need to have a advisor or a partner who can focus on this, is because a lot of your time is going to be consumed during this period. So as an entrepreneur, there will be, I mean, the investors, investment manager will be constantly behind you to answer queries, to understand the business model, etc. This period sucks up a lot of your bandwidth. So once he has sort of convinced himself about the business plan and all that, he presents it to his internal investment company, right? And that one, suppose you get an approval, suppose he gets an approval, that's when they go for the, they give you a term sheet, something called a term sheet, right? A term sheet is usually a not a binding document. It's not a legally binding document. It is a document which sort of says, I and you agree to have this investment done on these 10 terms, right? Like he was talking about buyback, right of first refusal, those things. And once that is submitted, they go for a due diligence process, which is legal and accounting due diligence. I'll explain that. And finally, the whole agreements are signed. There are two or three agreements. Usually two agreements are signed, the subscription agreement and the shareholders agreement. We'll discuss that too. There could be other agreements also. I mean, depending upon the nature of your company, there could be employee, key employee agreements. There could be even non-compete agreements. A lot of those kind of agreements will also be signed. So like you said, this process takes 6 months, and this we are talking about a fairly, our experience has been that this is true for a company which is very, very well prepared for the fundraising process. If companies are not well prepared, it will take anywhere between 8 to 8 months to a year for that. And when I mean well prepared, what I'm talking about is your business plan that they were discussing in the morning is extremely clear in your mind, and that you are able to validate those assumptions or whatever the underlying assumptions of your business plan very, very clear in the discussions. So what this session, the way I have structured it, and I wouldn't want to follow this very strictly, I would rather like this to be a more interactive session. Is structured as per this sort of process. We're starting with knowing your business, which I think they have covered a lot of it, so I'm not going to focus a lot on that. Which is basically understanding your business plan. And then we'll go into how you select and approach an investor. And third is business evaluation. What is the process that an investor follows in business evaluation? And what are the things that, how does negotiation happen? What are the key clauses that are negotiated. And then due diligence and what is the kind of closure formality involved. So this is something that was covered in the morning, but like I think this sort of answer your question. Sorry, I didn't get your name.
Umang.
Umang. So Umang, this I think when you should raise capital, that is a very critical question in the sense that if you raise it too early, right, there is a very significant chance that you will dilute yourself so much that you will be left with nothing. And we have seen entrepreneurs doing that a lot. They end up diluting say 70% of the company in businesses which are fairly capital intensive, right? And the, when the second round happens, they'll end up with less than 10% stake in the business. So the question of when to dilute, there is not a single point answer. But the question is, if like Anil here, when they went for the first round, right, they could demonstrate to the investor a certain amount of visibility on the business, right? That's very critical. Ultimately, you're selling the story, but the story should not be so fantastical that they don't believe it at all, right? So, and it can be too late also because you don't have enough unlimited money on your hands to just throw at the business. So, if the I think the critical point that which yes, we think businesses should raise money is when there is sufficient visibility on say projections for the next 6 to 12 months, because that is where the investor will look at, right? Nobody looks at 5-year projections in early business, early stage business. Business plan for most people, Excel business plans are Excel, that's it, Excel, spreadsheets. They are just a starting point. So what is critical is, do you have visibility on what is going to happen 6 months on? And that's what is, you should sell the business to the investor for. And you should also be clear why you wanted that, right? I mean, sometimes entrepreneurs, one mistake that entrepreneurs make a lot is not raising enough capital. That happens because they underestimate their costs a lot. So it's very critical that you clearly understand what are the requirements of that, what are you going to use it for? And you should clearly know that because investors are not going to fund working capital. Right? Most investors will not fund working capital. They'll only fund maybe a part of that working capital. Right? What they're interested is in capital that will help you grow your business, which could mean investing in people, investing in some amount of fixed assets. So again, fixed assets also, it should not be such that in an early stage business, if you're putting in a lot of money in fixed assets, right? Sometimes they get scared of that because there is a risk there. Because you are investing a lot of money in fixed infrastructure while your revenue model is still not proven. So that you have to be very clear that what kind of capital, where are you going to deploy this capital in? How much capital? So the critical thing is actually understanding, if I raise say 5 crores right now, where can I go with that 5 crores? 6 months away. And can I convince the investor that with that 6, like Anil did here, that my business is worth 60 crore, 100 crore, whatever. That is critical.
One thing,
capital assets, when the business model is still unproven. So they want maybe you to stagger the investment over a time period. For example, let me give you the example of any warehousing business, right? They'll say you put that money in that particular asset, but first prove to me that that investment works, that that model is feasible. Then raise additional amount of money, right?
I put the same question. I need a warehouse. Say to stock 6 months of fishmeal, right? So I need the warehouse to stock the feed. That money they will not give it to
you. No, I didn't say that. All I said was, they said, you don't come in, don't set up 5 warehouses simultaneously.
Oh, they want to say that your assumption has to be justified.
Yes. So first, you sort of take the money, prove the model first, and then take additional money. Right? Where it can be financed by a bank, right? Go for the bank funding because that's better for you always. Why take equity money? That's a logical video of it. So like I said, like I was just explaining to him, there are various ways you can do it. I mean, there is bank funding available, there is H&R money out there. And the kind of structure you will use depends also on the kind of investor. Some investors will be comfortable with a banks should be comfortable with debt, you could have the equity structure. Quasi-equity is something like what is called a convertible debt kind of structure. That you can sort of explore a little later. But each time, there are different variety of investors in the market, and which investor you need to approach also depends on the kind of requirements you have as a business, right? So let's now talk about approaching an investor. This is something that Anilu was also talking about. So, as some of you here have decided to sort of approach, talk to investors, and one of the questions I think somebody was asking was, what kind of investors we should approach, right? That's one of the questions that see, in India, the understanding of impact investors, right? In India, most investors are very commercial focused. I would say that even impact investors, the return expectation difference between an impact investor and a commercial investor is not very huge, to be very honest, right? What differs is the level of patience with your business. A commercial investor from day one is going to be behind you to scale, right? So let me take an example. In a rural business, right, all of us know there are challenges in working with, say, if you're especially working with distribution models, or you're working with a distribution model, you are working with maybe farmers, somebody else is working with rural producers, all these models have some inherent challenges in scaling up, right? So the difference between a commercial investor and an impact investor comes is not in the return expectation. Everybody in this investing, at least in India, everybody expects at least 20%. Because there is a reason for that. The reason is simple. There is a certain hurdle rate that every investor commits to his own investors. Okay? It could be say 15%. Now, it so happens that in India, early stage investors, maybe 2 out of 10 investments succeed, the rest fail, especially in impact investing, right? So you have to make the maximum amount of money with those 2 investments. So the hurdle rate on most successful investments would at least be 40% for an impact investor.
Can you give me an example of any for-profit enterprise that has given that kind of return?
In impact investing,
yes, in India.
See, in India, the returns, very few exits have happened in the impact investing guys. In microfinance, one exit that we know is a South-based company. I will not sort of take a name there, but that in that particular at the heyday, in the heyday of microfinance, one of the earlier investors exited at a 50% kind of IRR
on the non-microfinance. Actually,
there hasn't been any exit. There hasn't been any exit in the non-microfinance space. Very limited. So, but I'm telling you, before they invest, that's the kind of return that they're looking for. I mean, from the successful investors. And there again, there are variations. You could have the one category of investors who are, let's say, the foundations. There are a few foundations who invest in for profit. Their return expectations would not be so high. I'm talking about more of the sort of slightly VC kind of investors. Their expectations are, I would say that they are not very different from commercial investors. But where they differ, I definitely agree, is that their level of patience with the entrepreneur is, and the level of handholding that they are willing to give is extremely high.
How much will they restrict you from running the business commercially? You know, of course, you are making a social impact, and that's what we are always worried about. That how many clauses and that they will have that you can't run, you know, business commercially. You always have to take care of the impact first.
See, there are, again, there are varieties of investors. There is an impact first investor and there is a profit first investor, right? So if it's an impact first investor, obviously the focus is going to be on impact.
So that will restrict...
That could restrict, depends on, see, again, there are no general
that will actually.
It depends whether, that's why their emphasis always is on saying that your model should be, impact should be integrated into your model rather than you doing impact as a side activity, right? If you do that as a side activity, obviously you will be restricted.
It's not a side investor.
Yeah. So that's pretty. So there are categories of investors. There are impact investors, there are impact first investors, profit first investors. I would categorize most of the investors in India, so called impact, as profit first. At least some more important ones who can commit large amounts of capital. And the difference is that if you are talking about some of the more, obviously there are reporting requirements and all that they follow. But I don't think that we have not seen cases where impact seriously hampers the growth of an organization, because ultimately they are also very pragmatic in the sense that they see that they also have to exit from the investment 5 years or 7 years down the line. If they are so close jacket the or straight jacket the entrepreneur, there is a chance that that will not happen.
It does happen actually, so that it's a small case that someone wants to, you want to scale your business, and there's a way that you look for subsidies from government and you scale the business, you get bulk orders. But as a company, we have a priority that we sell the product in MRP. We want to create that this thing that the product flows off the shelf. It will take more time, to achieve that. But the impact will be slow in that case. But we are more confident of, selling the product off the shelf at MRP and not looking for government subsidies all the time. So
it depends. Like I said, it's the kind of investor you bring onto the table. So you have to be very. That's why knowing the investor is very critical.
And that's why I like the point that you talk to the investees, these other investing companies.
Exactly.
That's a very good point.
So the kind of approach they follow, I think it's very critical when you sort of start talking to investors that you do thorough research. Like Anil was mentioning, it's very important you do that. And I think what are some of the things that you should be looking at when you do that? When you do that, is some of these things. Like first take, if you have identified the investor, first thing you should do is just go and look at the portfolio of companies that they have invested. What kind of companies do they invest in? That will give you the first basic clue of what kind of investor they are. So, for example, if you go to Sequoia's website, you'll find a lot of technology investments.
E-commerce,
technology investments. But Sequoia has invested in a company like India Sector Finance also, right? So, first thing that. Then, I think it makes sense for you to talk to those guys. Because, like you said, websites only give 10% of the information. The real information comes out post-investment by talking to the entrepreneurs. How, and the critical things that you need to assess is how, what kind of leeway does this investor give you in terms of running your business, right? How supportive is it? And supportive, I don't mean just saying that, okay, I'm behind you. But does he give you, sort of provide his networks and help you to scale up the business? That's very critical. So you have to talk to, if you can manage to talk to these entrepreneurs, excellent. That's very critical. Exits. Now, exits is closely related to the kind of investor they are. Some investors say openly that I want 10x money, 10 times my money in 4 years. Obviously, that is not the kind of investor that most of us would want to. I mean, you would love to be associated with some of the big names, but our business models don't allow that. 10x returns in 4 years might not be possible in some of our business models. So the question is, how did they exit? What kind of returns were they looking at when they exited? It will be very important to understand that. And some of that data is public, by the way. Some of the exits that these guys have made would be public. Especially if it's a trade sale or a IPO, it would be public. And this is critical. I mean, the experience of the investor team, the person who is coming on your board, like you were saying, he did reference checks on the person who is coming on the board. Why do you think that is necessary? As entrepreneurs, why do you think it is necessary that somebody coming on your board, you do so much reference checks? What is your idea of an investor representative? What does he do on the board?
What I understand is, once they understand your business thoroughly, then they look very exactly, the business is lacking in which areas. Accordingly, they bring in the professionals into your board.
the decision that you take, you have to take approval of the board member. And,
yeah, sure, but like what role, that is the procedural part. What role does an investor representative play on your board in your business?
He is basically the representative of the investor, so he is looking out for the investor's interest. The interest is obviously that he will do well so that he does well.
That's one thing, but what is also critical is that is he able to bring in this experience into scaling up your business?
That's what we would look into.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to tell you. That I was asking you, what would you look for other than the procedural aspects? What would you look for in an investor or from an investor? One thing is obviously networks. So somebody like a Sequoia would bring amazing networks, right? But there is another social impact investor who is a small investor operating out of say Europe. Now you need to assess, there are trade-offs here. There is an impact investor who understands your business, is very patient, is very very impact focused, this thing is aligned with yours, everything is very good. But is he the right investor for you? The question there is that person able to, or that investor able to offer you something in scaling of your business? Is he able to offer you networks, understanding of processes? Has he done that? Is he an entrepreneur? Or is he just some fresh grad who has come in and joined the fund? And because those people will be useless. It will be just like they are giving you the money. If money is all you want, that's fine. Right? But if that is not all you want some value other than that from the investor, it's very critical that this aspect be analyzed very carefully. Exactly. Because there are investors who come on your board and will say, okay, I gave you so much money, I'm going to relax. After 5 years, I want so much return. There are those kind of investors. The HNI investors, like there are various categories of investors. The high net worth individuals are typically that. The people who come in and individuals who have a lot of money come and fund you in the early stages of the enterprise. They just come and relax. They don't provide a lot of value add other than that. Stage of fund. Any clues on what this means, stage of fund? So you people would have known by now that every fund has a fund life. 10 years, some have, there is an investment horizon, investment time period, and then there is the rest of the period is for exits, right? So typically a fund, once it's set up, it invests for 4 to 5 years. The rest of the period is spent for exits. The investments made during the first 5 years are exited during the next 5 years. So it's very critical that you sort of understand where they are in their, if they are in the fifth year and they're making investments new.
In 5 years.
Lesser. They buffer. They take a buffer of maybe 3 years, 2 years. Maybe you have 3 years left. Right? Amount left. Why is this critical?
They have a mutual pool of funds that they raise and which have already pulled up, sold out.
They move much more generous, if I can use the word, and they have the entire pool, rather than if they have 20.
No investor is generous. Not generous is not the right word.
They are in a hurry to exit. So they are trying to push you for.
Flexible, I would say. It is actually very critical for most of the entrepreneurs in the social impact space, because it makes great sense to partner with an entrepreneur, with an investor who has the ability to commit money in successive rounds.
Yeah.
Right? But today, for example, what is your business?
Solar pumping.
Solar pumping. So, if you are going to estimate your capital requirement right now, if I may ask you, what is your capital requirement going to be? Fine. Now, when did you start your business? How long was it? So, you are still in the early stages, you are still sort of figuring out the business model and...
Yeah.
But how the business will scale up in the next 1 or 2 years, your visibility might not be very, very high. It could be there, but the visibility might not be good. That's a typical case with a early stage enterprise, right?
Just for better understanding, I think visibility is also very good. We already have confirmed order 400
What I'm trying to say here is, let me call this case for example. The orders
in
can
this case only, visibility is also very key.
Visibility is high, but the order level can multiply suddenly, like
yeah,
1 year down the line.
That's how why we want to raise that capital to reach.
So, I'm not saying the visibility in sort of there will be a downward thing, but your order level could just shoot up suddenly.
Yeah.
Now, tomorrow your order level shoots up.
Are you trying to understand and explain us the assumptions and its visibility has to be clear?
No, I am explaining to you this point about amount left. The investors, what kind of money do they have on hand at the moment when they make the investment? And why that is critical? Because the next round, when it happens, and it might happen say 3 months down the line. For your case,
yeah,
you might raise 5 million right now, you might burn up that money in say 6 to 7 months, I am just assuming. And then you might be again in the market. That might be again a 8 month process. Right? So always makes sense to go to an investor who has the ability to commit if necessary. Rather than this. So this point about synergies with existing investments, that I think is very, that's also important in the sense that it sort of helps to have another company which can maybe you can work with. Sometimes that's where you get some of your clients. So if the investor has invested in either some companies which have either can support your business or can be clients to your business, that could also be very useful for you. So how does an investor typically, I mean, lot of you have understand vaguely that there is a financial thing that the investor looks at. So most investors today, I mean, have any of you interacted with investors? Yeah? You have. So what is the, when they evaluated the financials of your business, how, what kind of questions were they asking?
Normally they ask this, they ask your balance sheet, how it's a big secondary of cash flow. That they try to understand your business, how much money is coming to you.
So that the reason they are looking at all this is simply to understand. Most investors are very fixated on something called capital efficiency. And by capital efficiency, what I mean is, if I put 1 rupee in your business, how much sales is that business going to do? How much sales is that 1 rupee going to give? Right? That's something that's very critical. That is a link between the sort of the balance sheet and the profit and loss account. Saying that if I put 1 rupee here, how much, what will be the sales, top line there, right? That's one thing they're focused on. The second thing which is very critical for some of us is a working capital, which is conversion of this profit and loss into cash. I might be making huge amounts of profit, but my cash conversion might be very bad, right? Especially some of us who are dealing with government contracts, there could be issues there, right? In terms of payment cycles and all that. So they look at that, they look at the conversion, and what is very critical is they also look at how, if I put in 5 crores or 5 million in your business right now, where is this business going to go, right? That is critical, because if I put in 5 million in your business and your business is at 10 crores or 15 crores 12 months down the line, then the issue becomes, you need another round of capital infusion, right? They'll get significantly diluted then at that particular point in time if you have not actually leveraged your capital fully. So they look at that also. That's what is capital efficiency comes in. But that's very critical. And the third thing that is very critical is the capital expenditure. I mean, capital, how capital heavy is your business model? Is it, are you pumping a lot of money into fixed assets in the initial stage, the point I was making earlier? Is that something that is very, very important for your business? Have you proven your business at the unit level? Most investors look at the unit level economics. So for example, if you're into a distribution business of some product, they will say look at the distribution economics of your one, say, distributor center. What doesn't make sense after I load all the overheads? That's what they'll look at. Right? So you have to prove to them, because simply because at the overall level, it doesn't make sense in an early stage industry. Because mostly the overheads are so huge that you won't be making any money. But at the unit level, sometimes it makes sense to look at it. And you can make better sense of the financials of the unit. And the other thing that most investors look for in early stage enterprise, and this cannot be emphasized on a lot, and it's something that's very, very important, is a promoter team. Like Anil was saying, that a single promoter sometimes he has to be Superman to run an early stage enterprise and raise money and do everything that is required to scale up a business. So they look at a serious, good, strong team which has a lot of these characteristics. I mean, when they're talking about, they're looking at people who are in the long, for the long term, long haul. And especially people, if they're people who have done this before, it becomes all the more, you should highlight it. If you've done something like this before, definitely makes sense to highlight this. If you've had a previous entrepreneurial venture, right? Or if you have experienced this, if you can demonstrate to them that you have an understanding of this business, through either an academic this thing or maybe having worked somewhere else, it makes sense to demonstrate this. And the other thing is networks. I mean, the investor brings his own networks, but you should prove that some investors say that I think I would like to invest in an entrepreneur who has networks of his own. Right? That shows that he understands this business and has been around, he's been talking to people. So, all these things make it that. And these are the kind of things that an investor looks at in a promoter team. But all this, having said all this, I mean, when you're talking to an investor, I think sometimes that gut feel sometimes helps you. Am I going to sort of be with this guy for 5 years? Can I coexist with this guy on the board? Because he'll be sort of bugging you all the time. Every month, like you said, every month he'll be asking you for reports, he'll be asking for information, he'll be giving you ideas. Will you be able to coexist with this guy? That gut feeling, after all this, you should be sort of have the feeling that you have done all the analysis. Now you just should sort of have a sort of gut feeling that this guy will work for you. Right? So, once you have done all this, it's time to sort of go and pitch your business to the investor. And that, I think, is something that we're doing tomorrow. So I'm not going to sort of get into that in detail, but maybe you can enjoy this. Then we have approached the investor, we have done all that. Now the serious stuff happens. You know, funnily, investors are like a herd. You must have seen this in, I don't know how many of you have been following the e-commerce boom in India. You have been following. You must have seen the multitude of investments that are happening. I mean, I don't even remember the names of these companies. Why do you think this is happening? I am sure 70-80% of these companies will fail. Yeah, but why is this happening?
I see in a couple of e-commerce companies, the initial investors who 3 months you invested, the exit is like 1.5 years. So they made a return then.
They are the clever guys.
It's the story that we created, you know, the dream of e-commerce with 21% 21% internet penetration, this is the revenue, you know. Imagine what will happen if it is 80%, you know. So all that kind of statistics. Statistics are very, very easily made in e-commerce.
I'll give you an example in the microfinance, when the microfinance boom was happening. This will be in 2007 and 2010. So you could get all kinds of investors coming and talking to us because we tell them. Because we used to sort of look at microfinance space quite carefully. And these guys had absolutely no experience of the microfinance investing. And they would come and talk to us for simple reason that somebody else had made a microfinance investment. They had not done any work of their own. It's just that they're coming. They're saying there's a hot sector. Hot sector. Somebody has made, like you said, a massive return. And so I also want to. So that herd mentality is definitely there. So if your business is in that that nice category, you might turn out to be lucky. You just at that point in time when everybody wants to put money in that business. This is, I think, somewhat similar to the way the investments happen. The investment, this is a cartoon on the investment committee, how the investment committee works. It will not be very, very different in the world. So when you're, the person who will be interacting with you, when you go out to raise fund money, is somebody called an investment manager. An investment manager is like the person who does all the heavy lifting in a fund, of preparing the internal investment memo, preparing, vetting the financial model. He's a guy who will ask you very detailed questions, who will be bugging you all the time. So this is the kind of discussions that will happen with you, and this is where a lot of the time we see that the promoter, if he's not well prepared, that's where a lot of time is gone, back and forth. You go up to the investment manager with a business plan, the business plan is not comprehensive enough or not well thought out, and then there is a huge back and forth. You can go through this entire process, this investment manager discussions in a month, or it can take you about 4 months also. So you know that these are things that most of the things were discussed in the morning, so I'm not going to sort of focus on this. He'll conduct a field visit and all that to check the business. So once all he's done all the analysis, the process in a fund is that he presents this to the investment committee. Yeah, investment committee is usually the consists of the fund manager. And in some cases, consists of the investors in the fund, right? So they are sort of take a decision on the, well, and they look at various things. And one of the primary things they look at is exit. And when I say exit, it means a lot of things. It could mean the scalability of the business. Like Anil was saying, if you go to an investment manager with a 10 crore business plan, you'll be short of, definitely. You can't even take it to the exit. Because with 10 crores, you'll not even get any kind of exit. But the question is, how are you should be able to demonstrate to the investment manager that there is a chance of an exit. IPO is usually not the best idea to, like Anil was saying, in the Indian market, IPOs, I don't think will sell. Very few companies exit through it, very few investors exit through it. So the question is, you should clearly think through what are the possibilities that you can give to the investment manager, and in turn you should actually treat him as part of your team, because he is the one who is selling your business to the investment firm. So you should give him, at times he doesn't understand your business, he doesn't understand how he's going to exit. All those possibilities should be offered up to him. You are the best judge of your business.
How much are investors concerned about your own equity cashing out?
No investor is going to allow that in an early stage business.
Of course not the first round or probably the second round, but is that also part of the negotiation that you can't cash out the founder's equity?
You cannot. Most investors say that till they exit the business, you will not be earning cash out. Cash out as you are saying, completely cash out?
No, of course not. A part of your equity, you do use.
It depends on negotiation again. So, in some cases, we have seen that investors allow a portion of the equity to be cash out. And what they do is, they have a tag-along clause, which I'll explain later on. This tag-along is basically saying that if you sell as a promoter, I as an investor have the right to sell my equity also. So you might
in that ratio.
Yeah. So sort of if you've got a buyer for your shares, for say for who's willing to pay you 10 crores, right? The investor will say, I hold 50% of the company, you hold 50. So you sell 5 crore worth of your shares, I'll sell 5 crore. That's the way it will work. And sometimes people like Anil have negotiated stuff where the tag along is also not there. He says, I sell 10%, I sell 10%, I cash out 10%. It all depends on it. Like you said, there is nothing standard, right? All investors, he's very correct there. All investors come and tell you, all lawyers in fact, this is standard, this is templatized, this was approved by God. Nothing is sacrosanct. Everything is open to you. This is the usual situation on the negotiating table. Right? The investor is coming from somewhere, you and the promoter is coming from somewhere else. Especially on the business plan. The promoter says, I'll do 1000 crores in 5 years. So, you will not even get 15 crores. And then the valuation is negotiated. On what basis? Don't ask me sometimes. So, there are certain concerns each of them have. And most investors' concerns are early stage businesses, exit is a primary concern. Why? Because you are at a 5, most of the business in early stage will be at a 5 crore turnover, 10 crore turnover, 15 crore turnover. From that to go to a 1000 crore turnover, which can offer an exit to an investor, is, I'm not saying it's impossible, but it's very difficult in 5 years. Most businesses will not grow. So that becomes very, very critical, and that is a clause that is why what Anil was talking about, buyback clauses. So what investors have been doing in recent times is putting something called a, there was something called a put option earlier. RBI said you cannot do it. Put option is basically I selling my shares to you. I have the option of selling the shares to the company or to the promoter. So RBI said that is not equity, it is now you are making a debt investment. So they overruled that. But that's a primary concern. And valuation, obviously, I mean, that is another concern that most investors have. For the promoter, I think the concerns are primarily the management control. I mean, it's just barely, how is he going to run this? What amount of control will he have on the operations of the company? Those become, so it's a question, the negotiation usually happens on a few of these things. What we have seen, I mean, in real life, these are the things that are usually negotiable. And as a promoter, I think it's very critical that you take a clear stance on some of these things before you go into a negotiation. Anil, for example, took a very, very clear stand on certain things. Like he was talking about indemnities. He took a very clear stand that I will not allow this. So it's very critical that when you're going into a negotiation process, what is, I think as investment bankers, we'd advise you that you as promoters be very clear on what you're willing to give up and what you're not willing to do. Absolutely not willing to do. You're willing to break the deal but not willing to give up. You need to be very clear about it. Now let's go to the term sheet. I think before going to the term sheet, let's just look at some issues in valuation of early stage enterprises. How many of you have a background in finance? Any of you have? So like in a normal stock market kind of investment, nice stable business, you have a very nice cash flow. Usually there are some methods employed, like discounted cash flow, all that doesn't work here in early stage businesses. Like Anil was saying that they arrive at a 60 crore valuation. In most cases it's just a hunch. And valuation in most of these cases is posturing. People coming and say, promoter saying that I have a 60 crore number, there's no way you can justify that kind of number to anybody. Right? So, but what is important there is something called the IRR. The usual way investors do valuation in early stage companies is the IRR method. In which what they do is they ask you, so like I said, there would be initial discussions on the valuation with the promoter. And they would say that, okay, this is the kind of return I want from this business. If I invest at this valuation, will I get this return? That's what they typically look at. So the, your business plan, like most investors take your business plan and do a haircut on it. From 50 crore, they'll take it down to 25 crore. Right? And then they'll do an IRR analysis. It's basically saying if this business plan is achieved, what kind of return can I make on this? In the negotiation discussion, right, I think these are some of the things we have seen affecting valuation discussions. Like I said, in early stage businesses, valuation is an art, completely an art. There is very little science to it. It's a completely an art. And how you approach the investor and how you deal with him and how you negotiate with him is far more critical. Sometimes you might have two options on the table. How are you able to play off the two of them? So you might have two investors approaching you saying that they will invest in the company. If you are able to play them off, you might get a better valuation. How you respond to emails, even that sometimes gives sense of the message. The kind of tone you take, the kind of value. Sometimes investors say, no, we are walking away from this deal. That could be posturing. Similarly, you can take the body language, everything matters in a negotiating, on the negotiating table. Right? It's very critical. So it's actually your desperation to make an investment that is, desperation to take the investment that is so critical in the whole process. Obviously, if you are able to demonstrate visibility on the performance, if you are able to demonstrate that visibility, that sort of helps you improving the valuation. These are some of the structures that investors use in doing investments. Have any of you heard of these structures? Compulsorily convertible preference shares, compulsorily convertible debentures, warrants, tranching of investment is just a structure. So typically what all these structures, I mean the fundamentally these are all names, but the underlying problem that they are trying to solve is that nobody knows the valuation of the business. You don't know an investor. Right? So to protect each other's interests, what you do is you say, okay, I'll put money in this business, 50% of the money will be as equity at this valuation. The other 50% will be on achieving certain milestones which Anil was talking about. So what you might agree on, what you might agree for this kind of a structure if you are visible. That's where the visibility thing comes to become very important. This might have its upside in the sense that if you achieve your plans, you might, or you overachieve on your plans, you might have a lower dilution. But if you don't achieve, there would be a corresponding higher dilution. The other structure which is slightly tax efficient, in the sense that it's called a compulsorily convertible debentures, where the company issues debentures to the investors, so there is an interest outgo to the investor. So that can be expensed. If you are, that's, you are liable for tax. Warrants are something that are given to promoters in cases where you say that if I achieve a business plan, I get warrants. That is the right to subscribe to shares at a certain predetermined price. That's also used in some cases. But then it becomes slightly tax inefficient for you guys. In the sense that if the current value of the share is 100 rupees and you issue warrants at 50 rupees, you'll have to pay tax in the other thing. It's somewhat similar to a sweat equity. So what structure you will use on most early stage investments use one of these structures. So I think it makes sense for you to sort of understand these structures, what are the implications of these structures. So main implication of most of these structures is on the milestones. I mean what he was talking about there. What kind of, so you have to be very very careful on the kind of milestones you agree with in all these structures. And to answer your question on the when to raise capital, what are the methods could be the tranching of investment, where you tranche it out, right? So you want say 5 million now, but maybe you will not require the entire 5 million then. It could be spread over a 12 month, 18 month period. You could tranche it out. How many of you have seen a term sheet? Yeah. I'll just sort of show you one of the term sheets on, this is a sample term sheet. So once the investor has decided that he wants to put money in your company, and this is prior to due diligence and all that, he gives you something, a document called a term sheet. This, like I said, is not, this is exactly the language that we use. The term sheet is non-binding and for discussion purposes only. But it's obviously not for discussion purposes. If you don't honor that term sheet, you'll be in trouble in the market. In the sense that he's not going to sue you, but no investor will touch you up, right? So it makes very, a lot, though this is non-binding, it makes great sense for you to spend a lot of time looking at this and sort of feeling very, very comfortable with this document. And this is where a lot of time goes, this particular document. A lot of negotiation happens before this document. A lot of negotiation happens once this document comes to you. Most good investors, what they do is, they spend a lot of time with you discussing each of these important clauses before giving you something else. Right? But some of them just hand it out, which sort of so let's just look at some of the clauses that so in this page there are a few clauses. One is valuation. Valuation is clearly stated in this term sheet. What is a valuation? How it will be determined and what will be the structure? Like I explained the structure, say convertible, preference shares, etc. Same thing will be explained. What is the investment amount? Now this investment amount is conditional upon this due diligence happening. Right? The entire investment is actually conditional upon the due diligence happening. It's only a sort of a document saying that, okay, you and me now agree that we are going to take our discussion to the next level. That is what this document says. You can see some in this thing on board of directors. They'll say what kind of representation I want on the board of directors. Usually most investors go for one board seat at least. They might go for one board seat and something called a board observer. This observer is the one who can come and sit in your board meetings and take notes. You will not actively take part in the discussions. The board, there will be an investor representative who is an investor nominee.
Investor for company. Supposing that the company is equity.
Sorry?
Supposing that the company is equity, then automatically the director of the
paper. Not automatically, not necessarily.
Maybe. Let us assume that there is a director of the board. After that, the company wants to raise debt. So wouldn't the director give personal guarantee also?
Why would he give personal guarantee? First of all, he is a investor, he is himself a representative, he is an employee of the fund.
He is not going to give any personal guarantee to his director.
Why would he give? He is an employee of the fund. The fund is
coming. Basically, that is also a negative.
What is critical for you to sort of look at is this part, the minority protection rights, which is basically saying that for all these things that are listed out here, you need to get the investors approval. This could be, typically there is a difference in the approach that an investor takes. The investor is usually somebody who sees himself as a passive financial investor. You are running a business, I am putting my money in. So I need certain rights to protect my interests, and those are these rights. It basically tells the promoter that, okay, you cannot take this business and sell it off to somebody else without my permission. That could be one of the things. The business plan that you make, it needs my approval. So those kind of things are sort of put into the term sheet. Why Anil was saying that you need a good lawyer is because of this. The implications of some of these clauses can be pretty tremendous in terms of on your company and on your person, on your personal self.
One question. I think the final agreement will carry all the things, what is the return with the investor, what everything will be there in the final agreement.
Even see this term sheet actually contains the most important clauses. The fine print, I mean, about how the procedures will happen will be given in the shareholder agreement. But the sum and substance of your agreement with the investor is in this term sheet.
Including the returns.
Yeah.
So, from a banker's point of view, this is neither equity nor positive.
What is not equity?
Now, after supposing that my company is taking an investor, where he has an agreement with me where everything is defined, including the returns. So, the moment I ensure a return to him, it is not a cost equity.
So,
it is not a cost equity the moment a return is defined. It may be in form of returns or interest, whatever it may be. It is not a cost equity and it is also not an equity. So, how the banker will analyze this fund in my balance? When I go to financial analysis, where will I put this money?
Why would a banker not consider that money is equity?
Because it cannot be considered because it's a debt.
Why?
The return is defined.
The what is the banker concerned about?
The moment I define a return or a rate of return, it becomes a debt. It is not an equity.
It doesn't. The reason I'm telling you is, what is a banker?
I think it's debt, 100% sure.
There's an ownership
involved. Ownership involved doesn't mean that I will give you 10 times return in 5 years. Ownership, if I'm in loss, you are in loss. If I'm in profit,
you are in loss. What is the definition? See, what is the banker concerned about? The banker is concerned about.
The banker will.
Please allow me to explain. What is the banker concerned about when he talks about weight and equity? So there is something called senior debt. You have heard of definitions called senior debt, junior debt.
The moment I'm going to calculate.
No.
Debt equity ratio, pure by tier. The moment I am going to calculate what is this, whether this is outside liability or whether I will consider as debt one.
If a banker tomorrow, if there is a cash flow issue to the company, can the company use this equity to pay off the debt?
Everything, the moment the money is there.
No, answer this question.
I am telling you, just take it through it.
So that is equity.
One thing. Whether it will be classified as a net worth or outside liability?
It is net worth.
If it is net worth, then why this interest or returns?
It is not interest. It is not interest. It is not interest.
Okay, it is not interest. It is returns. The returns are different.
Okay, let's do one thing. Let's have an offline conversation. I think there are a lot of people on this thing. It's by the way, it's net worth. I'll explain to you why. Right? This is on the bottom of the. This is what I referred to as a tag along line. So what this says is that if the promoter sells off his shares, the investor can also sell. What it's trying to ensure is that you have a strong disincentive to move out of the company, because ultimately the investor is depending on you to run the operations. This is what the key rights. There is a right of first refusal also. So if the company is raising capital, investors say that I have to sort of be offered the opportunity to invest in that. Sometimes it can prove to be a sort of a problem, because you go out in the market, right? You find an investor for money, but the investor says, no, I want to invest in this. So it becomes an issue. Some investors, outside investors, say that, do you have a right of first refusal on the listing? Then first go and talk to your current investor and then come. Because the investment manager in that fund, you'll have to go through the whole process of approval and all that, and in the end they will say that, okay, I have, my investor has a right of first refusal, so I cannot allow you to do it. Allow me to do this. And the most important clause, which I think in the term sheet, is the exit clause. Like I was saying, this is what Anil was referring to, and usually they structure it as nobody says IPO and all that. Because they, most people know IPO is in a lot of cases theoretical. So they say there are certain things they say. There is a secondary sale, which he was also calling as one of the things is trade sale. That is, trade sale is selling your shares to another company. There is a secondary sale in which you can sell the, he can sell the shares to another share investor, financial investor. And then the other one that he was referring to is a buyback. Right? Promoter buyback. So you have to be very careful where you kind of obligations that you put yourself into in this particular clause, because this is very critical for them. But you have to ensure that your interests are not sacrificed in any of these clauses, especially things like buyback, put options and all that. Some people even go for something called a liquidation clause. Liquidation preference is basically that tomorrow, the most simple explanation of it is that tomorrow if something happens to a business and it has to be liquidated. Liquidation means essentially selling off the assets and turning into cash. He gets his investment amount plus a certain return first before you can take any amount of the business. This can be extended to the next stage where if there is a merger of your business with some other business, first he gets his returns and then you get, that is translated into shareholding in the merged entity. So it need not happen just in the case of a proper liquidation, but even a merger this might apply. Most of the investors are insisting on those clauses. And the other thing is exclusivity. Most investors would sort of say that the term sheet, for a period of say 2 months, we do due diligence. For that period, you are not supposed to discuss with any other investor. Term sheet is given, then there is a process of legal and accounting due diligence, which usually looks at all these things. I mean, like whether all that stuff that gets shown to the investor, is it really true? The financial statements, all the contracts that you claim to have, we check all that in this legal and accounting due diligence.
Who will you pay for the?
Usually the company pays.
Right.
It's a matter of negotiation. If you are in a strong enough position to say, no, I will not pay for this.
Because it involves a huge money, I think.
Sorry?
It involves a huge money.
Yeah, it does. Sometimes it involves at least 10 to 20 lakhs of your money, right? So it's a question of most investors would make you pay for it, but it's a question of negotiation.
Whether you want to be in the middle.
So this is a significant expense, so, and this is a negotiating item. Actual closure, once the legal and accounting due diligence is done, the actual closure happens with signing of two agreements, subscription agreement, which essentially and the shareholder agreement. Subscription agreement is basically saying that you have to do these things before I put money into your company. It is basically transfer the money into your bank account. You have to do these 10 things. Right? It also lays out the terms of how many shares will be issued, for what, what price, how much money will I put. That is the subscription agreement. And it also says what are called the warrants, sorry, the conditions before investment, conditions precedent. Like for example, they might say that you have to appoint a CEO before I put money into it. I principally agree to put money, but right now your management team is weak, so I want you to appoint a proper CEO. I would want you to put in place an employee stock option plan because you don't have money. This could be examples of conditions. So you have to be prepared for that. Usually there is sufficient advance notice of this, but makes sense to me. And the shareholder agreement is the crux of the your relationship with the investor. It sort of is a contract between you and the investor and the company, which lays out all the conditions. How you deal with the investor, how you deal with the investor. It's an extension of the term sheet, but in much more detailed fashion. So I'm not getting into all this. So after this 8-month process, you still have energy left, you have to go ahead and do the business plan. So if you have any questions, I don't know if this
thing was exit to social impact.
I think Puneet is here. He is the best person to sort of answer that question. But in a social impact fund, I think a lot of exits are going to happen from sale to mainstream investors if the business scales up sufficiently. Right? So if so typically social impact funds invest when the business is at say, like I was saying, 5 crores, 10 crores, right? In taking that business to a 200, 300 crores business is possible in say 4-5 years, right? So a 200, 300 crore business cannot be taken public and it cannot be IPO. Most probably you'll have to sell it to another investor, okay? That is the kind of exits that are going to mostly happen. IPO exits,
one example where say these 5 crores, 25 crore business goes to 300 crores in 4 years in impact investment only.
See, especially,
especially in agriculture.
There is a, so what I am trying to tell you is if there is going to be an exit happening, exit is difficult, right? In most of these businesses, exit is going to be extremely difficult. So, you're, like I was telling you, what is important is your ability to prove to the investor that an exit can happen in 4 to 5 years. That's very critical, or maybe 7 years, and that exit is going to happen most probably in the case of early stage business through sales to other investors. Anything else?
You explained that you need for how to do it. So as far as
statement, that we do, that we do.